Okay, so I'm talking to Jeanette Littlemore today.
Hi.
Hello. And we're going to talk mainly about metaphor, because that's what you were talking about this today here at the JOLT conference. But before we talk about that, could you tell us a little bit about how you started off in English teaching?
Yeah, sure. I did a degree in European Studies, and like many people, I suppose, I wasn't sure what I was going to do next. I saw all the adverts for jobs in Shell and ICI, etc., and then I saw teaching English in Spain, and I thought, that sounds like much more fun, and I went off and did that, and then I came to Japan to teach for a year or so after Spain, and found I really loved it, and stayed with it sort of ever since in one way or another.
So where were you teaching in Japan?
In Saitama, just north of Tokyo. I was teaching for the Shane School of English, and we were teaching in different schools every day, and it was a lot of teaching, but very good way of getting a lot of experience very quickly, and good fun.
So, as I said, you talked about metaphor mainly today, and that's your kind of research area.
Yes.
So what led you to be interested in metaphor?
What kind of got me very interested in it was when I went back to the UK after having lived abroad for about 9 or 10 years. I went back to work in a language teaching unit at university in Birmingham, and my job was to help international students with the language that they encountered in their lectures. And so what I had to do with quite a few of the students was go along to some of their lectures with them and listen to the sorts of language and then kind of like brainstorm afterwards the things that they'd found difficult. And one thing that struck me was that coming back to the UK, the language had moved on a lot in 9 or 10 years, and the lecturers were using a lot of terms that I was unfamiliar with, and most of them were very, very metaphorical. There were things like, it was in business and development studies, so it was things like ratchet mechanism or ring fencing, these kind of terms.
Kind of management
talk. Management talk, yes. And I was, in order to understand them myself, I was forming quite strong images to try and work out what they meant. And I could see that they were problematic for the students as well. And one of the things that I had to do was to put together a glossary for one of the groups of students of difficult terms that they'd found difficult, so that subsequent students turning up could use the glossary and kind of have like sort of like quick shortcut to understanding difficult terms. And when I looked at that, a huge number of those terms, probably about 80% of the terms, were metaphorical. So that was really what got me into it. Me, myself, having problems, and the students having problems with metaphor.
So can I just take you back to the basics, really? Can you explain a little bit about, I think everyone will understand what a metaphor is, but could you talk a bit about the different functions of gestures you were talking particularly about today?
Yes, of course. I mean, the reason why I got into looking at gesture is because I was interested in metaphor in talk, and I think that the spoken channel is only really half the story. It's a huge amount of information is conveyed through the gestural channel as well as the spoken channel, and a lot of the gestures are very metaphorical, the things that people are using. So I'm not using any particularly metaphorical gestures now, but maybe this sort of thing is talking about sort of movement and change and keeping the conversation together. It's a kind of metaphor there, as in kind of cohesion in the conversation is cohesion in the gesture. That's not very well explained, but it was the metaphor and gesture that got me into it. So some of the functions of gesture, you've got iconic gestures. This is one of the things I was talking about this morning, and I was talking about how like you might talk about a roof and you would use this sort of shape. This, of course, represents one part of a roof, not the whole thing, so which is why people call it a metonymic type of gesture, where one part represents the whole. There's also beat gestures, so the parts of the talk are sort of outlined like this. There's gestures that are conveying cohesiveness in discourse, so on the one hand, on the other hand. Pragmatic gestures, so pragmatic gestures would be things like your invitation is extremely appealing, but I'm afraid I really can't make it tonight because I've got something on. What's coming out of the mouth is kind of like quite positive. What's coming out of the gesture is not in a million years, and I wouldn't really want to come to your party or whatever it is. So these are some of the functions of gesture.
And we also had a couple of times we talked about different conceptual metaphors.
Yes.
And these are from, especially from Lakoff and Johnson.
That's right, yes.
But I was wondering if these conceptual metaphors were transferable across languages. So we have a lot of things like change is motion, difficulty is heaviness, analysing is cutting.
Yeah.
Are these specific to English, or are they often transferable?
I think some of the very basic, the primary conceptual metaphors would be very universal. But there are some which I do think change, and some of the things are, for example, the seat of the emotions for us is in the heart, whereas for people in Malaysia, it's the liver. In some languages, tomorrow, the future is in front and the past is behind, whereas in other languages, the future is behind because we can't see it, we don't know it's coming. And the past is in front, we've experienced it so we can see it. And this often comes out in the gestures. So you might find that a student is speaking quite fluently in English, but their gestures, yesterday I did this, tomorrow I plan to do that, are kind of speaking a different language. So it's very confusing for the person who's listening to them, because they've got these two contradictory channels. And so I think that picking up the L1 type gestures, I mean, this is a bit of a difficult thing because they're quite idiosyncratic, but broadly speaking, L1 type gestures or L2 type gestures when they're learning a language is a part of learning a language.
So, well, that takes us on to the study that you talked about specifically today. You talked to four Chinese speakers who were advanced learners of English,
yes,
and four native English speakers from the UK.
Yeah.
And you had them talk about the same topics and analyse their gestures.
Yeah.
And what did you find?
Well, one of the things I found was that the people from the UK tended to use a lot more kind of almost aggressive kind of turn-holding gestures, gestures to make sure that people didn't interrupt, gestures to make sure that people were listening to them, whereas the Chinese speakers of English used more sort of conciliatory gestures, sort of bringing people into the conversation and not excluding them so much. I found one of the main findings, I must say that this is a study that I conducted with a research colleague, Rico, who I ought to acknowledge here. One of the things we found was that the speakers of English, the Chinese speakers of English, tended to use their gestures quite a long time before they produced the actual word, which suggests they had more of a kind of cognitive function, that the gesture was there helping them find that word somehow. Package their information into English is one of the terms that people use. Whereas the native speakers of English would be using the gestures at the same time as the words, or sometimes even instead of them. So we have an example of one guy, he's talking about his roommate, for whom he had a lot of respect, but he was a little bit, you know, and he uses this gesture. And that gesture conveys an awful lot. I mean, it conveys that he was perhaps a bit square, a bit stiff, a bit rigid in his ways. But it's also like using the gesture rather than the words kind of mitigates it a little bit and makes it sound more, makes him sound less critical than if he'd use the actual words. So that was one of the differences. Also, differences in terms of the conceptual metaphors reflected in the gestures. With the Chinese speakers, sometimes they were talking about the past as being in front with a gesture, and things that are yet to come were in the past. Also, there's a conceptual metaphor that we have in English where things go from left to right, so on the one hand and then on the other hand. Whereas in Chinese, it can be the other way around. You can have on the one hand, on the other hand. And that came out in the gestures as well. The Chinese speakers of English would tend to be going from right to left, back to front. Also, emotions were in the heart, but also so was rational thought. That was in the heart as well. Whereas for the English speakers, it was in the head. So probably they're the main findings.
Do you think some of these differences were, of course it's difficult to separate them, but do you think some of them are cultural differences and some of them are more purely language related?
I think it's extremely hard to separate the culture and the language. I think the culture is in the language, and it leaves traces in the language. I think this is one of the things that people have found with metaphor, is that the metaphors that people, that are conventional metaphors in the language, represent culture of the country maybe 100, 200 years ago. It takes them a while to become crystallised and conventionalised within the language. So I suppose really that the gestural metaphors are kind of like yesterday's culture manifested.
How about English then, which is such an enormously widespread and diverse native speaker alone, you know, native speakers alone, but non-native speakers too. How do you think that will, what's the impact of that?
I think that you have different speakers of English from around the world with an overlapping set of gestures, but also their own gestures that go with those particular places, and also idiosyncratic gestures as well. I think there's a bit of a climb there. I think you can't say that everybody who speaks English uses this set of gestures,
of course.
Therefore you need to learn them, which is a problem for teachers because there isn't a kind of closed set that you can easily identify.
Well, I think that leads us on to the final section then. So what are the implications for teachers and for learners, do you think?
Well, I think for learners, it's important for them to be aware of if they are using gestures that are very sort of like, they've got a kind of L1 gestural accent, if they kind of speak a different language in their gesture from what they're speaking with their words. That's something to be a bit aware of. Attending to the gestures that people use in when they watch films, when they watch their teacher, etc., I think is important. For teachers, I think it's important that we're aware of the gestures that we ourselves use. Looking at the students' gestures for clues as to kind of what's going on in their minds. So if they're using these kind of, some of the things I've shown in my studies that when students are trying to think of an abstract noun, there's a lot of this goes on ages before they actually say it. So maybe that's a clue that we could perhaps help them out with it or give them some clues.
One thing you mentioned I thought was very interesting was that teachers who use more gestures are perceived as better teachers by
apparently,
students.
Apparently, yes.
Is that also across different cultures? Or
that's only one study that's looked at that. And I think it was teachers working in Japan, but I'm not 100% sure.
No. Well, it's certainly commonsensical kind of feeling to it. So
yes.
It's believable.
Yeah. You can see that. But then again, there's the other slight potential problem that maybe that might make things too easy for the students if they just have to watch the gestures. They don't have to understand the language. But generally, it is a positive. It's a useful thing for us to bear in mind.
So, final question. So you've done so much research, or you're looking so much and thinking so much about metaphor and gestures all the time. Does it make you feel so horribly self-conscious when you talk?
I'm always self-conscious when I talk. It makes me perhaps notice metaphors too much. I notice them everywhere I look, and metaphorical gestures, and perhaps when they're not there, because I think that, you know, sometimes they're there consciously, but other times they're so subconscious. That if you said to people afterwards, this is something I've noticed in my studies, when I've said, oh, look, did you know you were using this gesture, and this is perhaps what it means, they're usually completely surprised, and people didn't know that they were actually doing that and they were using that gesture. So, yeah, it makes me very aware, but as far as being self-conscious, nothing changes that.
Well, thank you, Jeanette. It was lovely to talk to you.
No, thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thanks.